We're looking at Mark chapter 11. We're going through verse 27. And as you can see, the words are on the screen. How long that will last, we'll find out. Anyway, you may well recall that last time when we looked at the Gospel of Mark, we looked at Jesus' triumphal entry. And we sort of looked at him, the conquering king, cursing the fig tree and clearing the temple as a symbol of him taking charge of the now defunct, non-functional temple. Now, the temple had all the marks of a thriving spiritual place where you should be able to meet God, but basically God was no longer there. It had been pushed out by greed. He had been pushed out by corruption. He was no longer there, and God was no longer going to be there. So we're actually going to go through a chapter and a bit this morning. Feeling exhausted already? I am. So we're going to fly through some of this. I will be up front with you. This is not going to be deep. I've already done that already. I've already thrown some people's theological understanding of God out completely by calling him Mother God. By the way, just to explain that, Trinitarian is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. When you're singing Mother God, you're just taking one aspect of God. And if you take God the Holy Spirit, you could be seeing that in that respect. It's got nothing to do with the teaching. I just know I might upset a few people this morning. Come and see me if you have. Anyway, so chapter 11, verse 27 to 12, verses 44. You ready? To summarize the entire lot, Jesus is in direct conflict with the Sanhedrin. These are 71 men. Sexual equality didn't exist then. These are 71 men who are the core of the Jewish religious and political body. They were a buffer zone between Rome and the Jewish nation. All 71 were a coalition, there's a nice word to use, were a coalition of both from the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the scribes, who were really sort of three different parties of the Jewish religious sections. So like Tories, Labour, Lib Dems. With me so far? Now, do we remember Kevin's brilliant description and how he got us to understand them all? Do you remember that? Standing up here, there was me this side, Andy, I think Barry was the other one, if my memory serves good, being the Christian. But a quick one, the Pharisees are close to Jesus and our understanding of the afterlife and the spiritual world. Sadducees believe in no afterlife and only the Torah, i.e. the first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Deuteronomy and Numbers, they are the top dog. It's only there that you should go to get what you need. The scribes had a reputation as experts interpretation of the Torah law. With me so far? Good. Because I give you this brief overview, because we're going to see Jesus now be challenged by all three sections in trying to potentially trip Jesus up. So, verses 27 to 33, read. Again, they entered Jerusalem as Jesus was walking through the temple area. The leading priests, the teachers of religious law, and the elders came up to him. They demanded, "By what authority are you doing all these things?" Remember, Jesus, you know, whipped the animals out of the temple, turned over the tables of money. "By what authority are you doing all these things? Who gave you the right to do them?" "I'll tell you by what authority I do these things, if you answer me one question," Jesus replied. "Did John's authority to baptize come from heaven, or was it merely human? Answer me." They talked it over among themselves. "If we say it was from heaven, we will ask why he didn't believe John. But if we dare say it was merely human, for they were afraid of what the people would do, because everyone believed that John was a prophet. So they finally replied, "We don't know." Lovely political answer, isn't it? And Jesus responded, "Then I won't tell you by what authority I do these things." Jesus used a Could you go back into the verses? Thanks, Steve. Jesus, the computer's working. Jesus used a typical rabbinic debating tool. He got asked a question, so a good debate is to answer the question back. Okay? That's good? Sometimes these days we tend to get asked a question and we try and find an answer, don't we? Have you never noticed that? When somebody asks you a question, actually most in our society these days, we try and rapidly think of an answer. But actually, here is a really good tool of actually going back and saying, "Well, hang on a minute, what do you think?" You'll find I do that quite a lot in there. You'll say, ask me a question, and I'll always go, "Oh, what do you think?" They want to know where Jesus' authority comes from because he's done nothing but challenge their authority. By forgiving sins, accepting sinners, calling the tax collectors into fellowship, redefining the Sabbath, casting out and cursing the temple. He's literally challenged their authority. And why did he refer to John the Baptist? Well, because Jesus was baptized by John. The heavens opened and God declared him his beloved son. Therefore, if John's baptism was merely human, then Jesus' authority, stroke miracles, can be explained away as fraud. Charlatan. But if Jesus' authority was from God, then as the people believe, then it means that Jesus' authority is above human authority. And actually, to explain that authority, one's going to have to go to God. Clearly, the Sanhedrin did not want it to be the last one. They couldn't admit it because they were scared of the reaction of the people, as John believed to be a prophet. So hence the coward's answer, "We don't know." So Jesus' clever response is to get them him out of having to explain. Forget it then. You know what the answer is, but the problem is it's removing your authority, your power base. You don't want to say. And you're too scared of the people. Authority. Verses 1 to 12. Then Jesus began teaching them with stories. A man planted a vineyard. He built a wall around it, dug a pit for pressing out the grape juice, and built a lookout tower. Then he leased the vineyard to tenant farmers and moved to another country. At the time of the grape harvest, he sent one of his servants to collect his share of the crop. But the farmers grabbed the servant, beat him up, and sent him back empty-handed. The owner then sent another servant, but they insulted him and beat him over the head. The next servant he sent was killed. Others he sent were either beaten or killed until there was only one left. His son, whom he dearly loved. The owner finally sent him, thinking, "Surely they'll respect my son." But the tenant farmers said to one another, "Here comes the heir to this estate. Let's kill him and get the estate for ourselves." So they grabbed him and murdered him and threw his body out of the vineyard. What do you suppose the owner of the vineyard will do? Jesus asked, "I'll tell you, he will come and kill those farmers and lease the vineyard to others. Don't you ever read this in scriptures? The stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is wonderful to see." The religious leaders wanted to arrest Jesus because they realized he was telling the story against them. They were the wicked farmers, but they were afraid of the crowd. So they left him and went away. Really, this is self-explanatory, because it actually is nicely explained to us in the Bible. It's quite helpful, isn't it? As a parable. Actually, quite normal imagery for Jesus to use. It was quite normal in Jesus' time that a landowner would leave his land with the tenants in charge. And actually, the tenants did tend to then treat the land as their own. And decide, well, the landowner ain't there and it's ours and we can almost do what we want with it. What's a modern day version, I suppose? I was watching that, caught a clip of that, Can't Pay, We'll Take It Away on one of the TV channels. And you get people there that have treated a rental property as their own, quite literally, and they've not even paid rent for 2 years and they're wondering why they're being evicted. It's not yours. But you can understand that somebody after a while would treat a rented property as their home after if they've been there for a very long time. And it's this same sort of thing. And we see here that Jesus, the servants, are the prophets that got sent before Jesus. And also, potentially, the tenant farmers are clearly meant to be the Sanhedrin here. The heir is clearly Jesus. The vineyard is from an Isaiah metaphor for Israel. So when he's talking about vineyard here, he's talking about Israel. But he's talking about the Sanhedrin. He's not talking about the Jewish people. It's very careful. He's talking about the 71, the political power, the religious power, not about the Jewish people. And clearly what's being stated here, you want to kill me, the son, because you want to keep the temple, you want to keep the power. And what fascinates me is that these religious leaders are so scared of the people. Have you noticed that? They're scared of what people think. So they know that their power, it's really annoying me, they know that their power is actually not really based in God. It's based in what the people think about them. Their position is based on what people think, not what on God thinks. So actually their authority hasn't come from God, it's come from the people. But it's a tentative authority, because if they really upset the people, if they really, really go to town and do something that's really out of their understanding or something, their power base has gone, because the people will turn against them. So they've got no God to fall back on. So actually, their authority is based on fear. They must spend half their life being fearful, because they're not sure if they're going to upset the people enough and the people are going to want to kick them out. But Jesus' authority is based on who he is in God. Hence why Jesus doesn't mind his authority here being challenged, because his authority has come from the Father. Where does your authority come from? If you're challenged about your beliefs in God, do you start going on the defense? Or do you start listening to the authority from God that you have? Do you worry about what people think of you? Or do you just sort of say, you know, I know that the Father loves me. Let's keep going, 13 to 17. Later, the leaders sent some Pharisees and supporters of Herod to trap Jesus into saying, this is now the Pharisees' question. So the Pharisees have arrived. Yay, Pharisees have arrived. Okay. Later, the leaders sent some Pharisees and supporters of Herod to trap Jesus into saying something for which he could be arrested. It's almost like some people at work, colleagues come up and ask them about Jesus, because actually what they want to do is trap them so that HR can come along and have a word. You laugh, but that's happened to members in this church in the past. Teacher, they said, we know how honest you are. If you can try and envisage now the almost the slime dropping off their tongue, they're trying to be so nice. Could you try and imagine that now? Such, grease, that's it. We know how honest you are, teacher. By the way, even them calling him teacher really is a false sense of honour they're giving Jesus. You are impartial and don't play favourites. You teach the way of God truthfully. Now tell us, is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay them or shouldn't we? Jesus saw their hypocrisy and said, why are you trying to trap me? Show me a Roman coin and I'll tell you. When they handed it to him, he asked, whose picture and title are stamped on it? Caesar's, they replied. Well then, Jesus said, give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar and give to God what belongs to God. His reply completely amazed them. Doesn't surprise us, does it not? Well, first and foremost, to trap Jesus, by the way, that word to trap, the actual imagery is violent, persistent hounding of Jesus. It's not just to try and catch him out. There is an evidence here that they are violently, in their persistence, trying to trap Jesus. It's like constantly at him. You know what I mean? It's like a constant hounding. You can almost feel the constant stamping of something coming at you all the time. So it's not like it's a moment and then Jesus gets a break for 2 weeks. It's like a constant hounding. And I love this false flattery, don't you? It's almost the similar sort of false flattery you can get sometimes when somebody comes up to you and says, my brother, I want to tell you this truth in love. Yeah? Go on then. Notice what my actions are now telling you. Or somebody comes into your workplace and say, do you know, I think you're such a lovely person. I'd love to know why you're always so happy or why you always seem to be at peace and content. I know that you're somebody that I can trust. So I want to tell you about this gossip about this other person and see if you'd agree with me. Yeah? Well, I love you. Could you tell me about where this great peace and comfort comes from? And you're like, oh, I get a pastor talking about Jesus. And you tell them, and then they go running off and complain behind your back. False flattery. Public display of support, but really behind the scenes, there is a real battle going on. Clearly, they were hoping that Jesus was going to say, no. You shouldn't have to pay your taxes. But actually, Jesus actually is supporting the paying of taxes and government by this statement. Paul wrote, everyone must submit to governing authorities. For all authority comes from God, and those in positions of authority have been placed there by God. So anyone who rebels against authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and they will be punished. For the authorities do not strike fear in people who are doing right, but in those who are doing wrong. Break the speed limit? You should be fearful. There's a rule. Would you like to live without fear of the authorities? Do is right and they will honour you. The authorities are God's servants, sent for your good. But if you are doing wrong, of course, you should be afraid, for they have the power to punish you. They are God's servants, sent for the very purpose of punishing those who do what is wrong. So you must submit to them, not only to avoid punishment, but also to be a clear conscience. Pay your taxes too for these same reasons. For government workers need to be paid. Those who work in the council will go. Those who work in social services will go. Amen? No? If you don't want to be paid, that's fine. I know there's a number of you here. They are serving God in what they do. If you work in any way, shape or form for the council, even if you're subcontracted via your company, you are working for God. Yes. Give to everyone what you owe them. Pay your taxes and government fees to those who collect them. And give respect and honour to those who are in authority. Ooh, there's controversy. But here there is clear evidence that we are to respect those in government. We are to pray for them. Yes. They may not know God for themselves. Doesn't mean they won't hear God's voice in the decisions they're making. They may not acknowledge it as such. But here, Jesus is not saying, you ignore government. God's put them in place for a reason. And by the way, it's not the resigned attitude of, don't worry, God is in charge. We still pray for them. We must always stand up. When there's an injustice being done, we continue to scream about the injustice, okay? Good. Anyway, but here is the fact that I love this, is give to Caesar, which give to God what is God's, means literally that God is sovereign over all. The way that it's been written here and the way that Jesus stated, God, what belongs to God, give to God, God is sovereign over all. The image of the Caesar on the coin is give and give it to, you know, give it to Caesar, because this is his image on this coin, it's his. And actually when he says give to God what is God's, you are made in the image of God, yes? So therefore, then actually, the same principle works here. If you're made in the image of God, like the image of Caesar, you give to God what is God's. And if you're made in the image of God, you give of your...
self.
Thank you. See the point? Give to God yourself as a living sacrifice. It's the same imagery. Not just about paying here, in this case, the temple tax or the tax to the government. It's actually about giving yourself to God. And not just on a Sunday morning. Sadducees question. Then Jesus was approached by some Sadducees. Religious leaders who say there is no resurrection from the dead. They pose this question. Teacher, again, false flattery. Moses gave us a law that if a man dies, leaving a wife without children, his brother should marry the widow and have a child who will carry on the brother's name. Well, suppose there were seven brothers. Seven brides for seven brothers. No, sorry. The oldest one, did you not... Seven Brides for Seven Brothers, who knows the movie? Howard Keel, shall I start singing?
No.
No. Good. Oh, what a beautiful brother. Anyway, his brother should marry the widow and have a child who will carry on the brother's name. Well, suppose there were seven brothers. The oldest one married and then died without children. So the second brother married the widow, but he also died without children. Then the third brother married her. This continued with all seven of them, and still there were no other children. By the way, don't be the eighth. Don't be the eighth. Clearly you marry this one, something goes wrong. Last of all, the woman also died. So tell us, whose wife will she be in the resurrection? For all seven were married to her. Now about you lot, I'll be getting... Oh, now hang on a minute, I've just gone back to you. Let me just get my books out. Let me try and unpack this theologically for you. Now, actually, this story, by the way, that's coming out, was actually in some writings prior to Jesus' birth. So this, they weren't something they just picked out of the blue. It's almost a story doing the rounds of an imagery and trying to unpack this Seven Brides. I think it's in one of the apocryphal books, the ones that are in between the... You get them in the Catholic Church, take them on board. If you've got an NRSV Bible, you'll find you'll have all of those sections in there. It's got great names, but books like Tobit, Bell and the Dragon. Seriously? brilliant. If you read Tobit, he really thinks he's brilliant. I, Tobit, am the most excellent of men. Like the humility, don't you? Anyway, got nothing to do with this. So this is not them making up a story. This is something that's doing the rounds. So Jesus has got clearly knows this story. So Jesus replied, your mistake is that you don't know the scriptures and you don't know the power of God. He's just said to the Sadducees who hold on to the scriptures like they are God. And he's gone, you don't know the scriptures. It's quite insulting. Actually, you think you know something, you don't. Because you don't know the power of God. You've narrowed yourself down to facts in the first five books of the Bible. It's like talking to a scientist. If you're a scientist, excuse me, I'm not being offensive. But it's like talking to a scientist who doesn't believe in God. They just look at all the hard facts about the world and the hard facts about what's going on and said there's nothing that can change outside of this. But you're actually saying, well, you don't know the facts because you don't know the power of God. With me? Cool. Am I the only one who's getting hot? So you don't know. For when the dead rise, there was no mucking about for Jesus. For when the dead rise, i.e. there is a resurrection. For when the dead rise, they will neither marry nor be given in marriage. In this respect, they will be like the angels in heaven. Does not mean you're getting wings. But now, as to whether the dead will be raised, haven't you ever read about this in the writings of Moses, in the story of the burning bush? This is brilliant. Jesus now takes a moment that is in the first five books of the Bible, the bit that the Sadducees will definitely latch onto as, that's true, without fail. That moment, the burning bush story, Moses meeting God for the very first time. Long after Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob had died, so Moses meets Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who the Sadducees again will go, whoa, they're the starter. They are our people, okay? Are you with me? Sadducees think they're fantastic. Moses meets them way after they've died. And God, Yahweh, says to Moses, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. So he is the God of the living, not the dead. You have made a serious error. Whoa. Okay. You have made a serious error. What he's trying to say is here is this, look. Why would God turn around to Moses and say, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, who are physically long dead. Why would I still can't be the God of them in the present tense when he's talking to Moses? So therefore, there has to be a resurrection because God would not say present tense, I am their God, if there's not going to be a resurrection. Because I am a God of the living, not of the dead. Do you see the point? So he's debunking their entire theological baseline, saying, you're wrong. Whoa, wisdom, wisdom, authority at its best. By the way, just as a sideline, I enjoyed this bit. The Greek word, actually, for when he talks about that you are in serious error and that you're seriously mistaken, actually, at the beginning, he says you are mistaken about the scriptures. Actually, the Greek word is planen, which we get our word planet from. Point of this is, the word really means you've wandered way off track, which, for me, is the term, modern term that we use, going, when somebody says something to you, go, what planet are you living on?
Yeah.
Same thing. Almost similar. So Jesus almost turned around and said, in our modern way of thinking, what planet are you living on? I like that. Scribe's question, ready? Verse 28. One of the teachers of religious law was standing there listening to the debate. He realized that Jesus had answered well. So he asked, of all the commandments, which is the most important? Okay, this Sadducee, this scribe is not now coming up to actually really trick Jesus. He notices that Jesus is answering really well. So actually now for this scribe, there's a sense of actually, I don't want to trip you up. I actually want to listen to what you've got to say. Genuine, I want to hear it. I want to receive what this teaching is, okay? Jesus replied, the most important commandment is this. Oh, by the way, go back a step. With all rabbis, like Jesus was, they would almost have like a summing up line about how they sum up the word of God, or how they sum up the whole sort of being with God. They would. So this is nothing unusual, almost like their slogan line, do you know what I mean? Yeah, and then look at the manifesto or the description afterwards. Look at all the small print afterwards. But like a summoning, like houses, reclaiming ground and restoring hope through the power of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's how, yeah, as a church. How all that plays out afterwards is a whole, there's whole SMART goals and strategic objectives and all that. So this is nothing unusual. This is not all Jesus, you are the Son of God. This is Jesus, the rabbi. Could you sum it up for us? So Jesus replies, the most important commandment is this. Listen, O Israel, the Lord our God is one and only Lord. And you must love the Lord with your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. The second is this, equally important, love your neighbor as yourself. No other commandment is greater than these. The teacher of religious law replied, well said, teacher, you have spoken the truth by saying that there is only one God and no other. And I know that it is important to love him with all my heart, with all my understanding and all my strength. This guy's doing well, isn't he? And to love my neighbor as myself. He's doing really well. Because he's also talking about his enemies. This is more important than to offer all the burnt offerings and sacrifices required in the law. This guy's doing amazing. How can I imagery this? And this is going to sound terrible, but you're going to hear me carefully. Loving God and loving your neighbor as yourself is more important than coming to every church meeting under the sun. It's more important than, funny enough, making sure we're doing all the right things. Because the right thing is loving God and loving your neighbor. Now, by the way, I don't mean that we don't meet up, give up meeting together, because we should do, because we're here to encourage one another. That's the point of meeting together. Come here, worship God together, encourage one another, listen into biblical teaching. It's about encouraging. But actually, connecting with our neighbours is more important. Being with them, loving them, actually genuinely loving them. Not seeing them as some nice pet project, but actually genuinely loving them. That's why, for instance, I'm going to say this now, actually, this Easter, these 2 weeks, we're going to be doing lots of things. We're going to be doing two things. One is posting leaflets through people's doors and praying for the street. You'll hear all about that next week. But one of the key things we want to encourage you over this Easter period is actually try and spend some time with your friends, neighbours, family who don't know Jesus. Invite them around for a coffee, barbie, whatever. Actually try and connect, spend time connecting with them, rather than spending time trying to do some big, massive church project where we all pounce on the streets of Broadway or something. Actually connecting with the people that God has placed to you next door. The family that you might visit over the Easter weekend. Did you see the point? Can you get a bit excited about that? Okay. Mum, that doesn't mean I'm coming around the house. But that's the point. And this scribe realizes that is more important than giving open burnt offerings and sacrifices to God. It's actually about putting it into practice. Realizing how much the man understood, Jesus said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." And after that, no one dared to ask him any more questions. The scribe was able to interpret the law of Moses into a practical, loving, daily act. And so therefore then, he's that close to the kingdom of God. All he'll ultimately have to do is recognize Jesus as the Son of God. He's sorted. He's that close. That means God's been working on this scribe as well. And what gets me here is that Jesus' authority is not once thwarted. He's able to give wisdom answers when his authority has been challenged. Carry on. Later, as Jesus was teaching the people in the temple, he asked, "Why do the teachers of religious law claim that the Messiah is the son of David? For David himself, speaking under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, said, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit in the place of honor at my right hand until I humble your enemies beneath your feet.'" Jesus is quoting Psalm 110, verse 1. By David. By the time of Jesus' time, this had turned into a psalm referring to the coming Messiah. Originally, this would have been God, would have been used as their anointing a king of Israel. The Lord, i.e. God, is anointing the Lord, small Lord, the king. But this eventually turns into now them waiting for the coming Messiah. Since David himself called the Messiah my Lord, how can the Messiah be his son? They're all waiting for a line of David to come. They're waiting for somebody in the line of David to come. But how can King David say that this ancestor that's coming be his Lord? How does that work? Well, clearly it does, because Jesus was God the Son before he was Jesus Christ. Yeah? The large crowd listened to him with great delight. Is that how you feel listening to me right now this morning? Great delight. Jesus also taught, "Beware of those teachers of religious law." Wasn't talking about me. For they like to parade around in flowing robes and receive respectful greetings as they walk in the marketplaces. And how they loved the seats of honor in the synagogues and the head table banquets. Do you know, I really laughed. They actually described all of this. And the places, the seats of honor, were the ones at the front of the temple that were to the side. You know, when you sit there and you go, might move. We don't sit there as a place of honor. We sit there so we can see all your beautiful faces. Do you hear the grease coming off my tongue? No. I sat and thought, maybe not. I don't have a flowing robe. Yet they shamelessly cheat widows out of their property. Ooh. And then pretend to be pious by making long prayers in public. Because of this, they will be more severely punished. I don't want to hang on that too much, but actually that shameless cheating widows, there was actually a true story prior to that in those times that's been scribed down, that a scribe, that one of the Sanhedrin had cheated a widow out of her money. I'm trying to remember her name. It's something like Fluvia, something like that. And this, so actually there was this scandal that had truly, truly happened. So Jesus is picking up on that. Wow. See, it's not just something Jesus made up. It's actually something that happened. Anyway, we understand what God is going at. He's attacking them publicly now, saying, you know, you still don't recognize that I am the Messiah. Be aware of them. They're going to look wonderful, but they're not really. And then this last thing. All of this power, all of this authority they're trying to hang on to, and it finishes with this. Jesus sat down near the collection box in the temple and watched as the crowds dropped in their money. Many rich people put in large amounts. Then a poor widow came and dropped in two small coins. Jesus called his disciples to him and said, I tell you the truth. This poor widow has given more than all the others who are making contributions, for they give a tiny part of their surplus, but she, poor as she is, has given everything she had to live on. Now, if you want to know, in the first half, we were meant to have done the offering prior to the teaching. So don't sit here suddenly thinking, oh yeah, typical, finishing on offering, we're going to be doing an offering later. That's not the point. This widow comes in. So she is the lowest of the lot. She's the widow. Look after this lot, you know. But she comes in and puts all that she has got in financial terms. But actually, she's also putting in all that she is. Everything about her is going into that offering to the Lord. She's got more authority in those two small coins than all of the Sanhedrin, all of these big guys in their flowing robes that people bow down to. She has got more authority in those two little coins at that moment because her heart is for God. Her heart is to love the Lord your God with all your... Come on. Can we go back to that? Verse 30. Thanks, Andy. It's quick, isn't it? It's not Andy's fault. This is the computer, I hasten to add. And one more. Cheers, mate. So to second is this. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your... And she was doing that at that moment. So here's the question to us. And this is it for me today, after today's teaching. Jesus was able to respond not because he was God, but because he had the power of the Holy Spirit in him who helped him. He also thought about these things prior to. As I said to you, some of the stories that they were coming up with, stuff that's done the rounds. So he's thought about things. So if we see things in the news that might question the authority of our belief in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, you know, sometimes we must cogitate on it a little bit. Sometimes think about it. What would be my response? What would be my response to people from Wednesday's atrocity in London? What is my response going to be to this Wednesday when finally Article 50 is triggered and the markets go all haywire? What is my response to people when I say, don't worry, God is in charge? Yeah, but people want to hear a real answer as well. They want to hear a genuine, look, it's not going to be all sunny and roses. It's going to be tough. But here is hope in Christ. What is going to be your response? It's like preparing for an exam, isn't it? When you sit down exam, you've revised, haven't you? Okay? When you get in there, you think, oh, I'm going to forget stuff. But strangely enough, things start coming, triggering your memory as you go. The Holy Spirit will trigger some memory in you, stuff that you've already thought about. But Jesus' authority was never challenged in himself because he knew where his authority came from. He was rested in the fact that he was rested in God the Father. He knew who he was. You know who you are. You should do. In God. So actually, within your deep inner core being, when somebody ever challenges you about where do you think you get all this stuff from? What makes you think that you know you're saved? What makes you think you know that Jesus died on that cross and rose again? What makes you think that God is in charge? What makes you think? You go, because I know in my deep inner being, in your core being, you will be at peace as you respond in the power of the Spirit. I got asked that question only last week by somebody who's really, really challenging, really wants to know, is really pushing at every angle with me. And do you know something? I said, there's a point that it, we went through all the usual logical arguments, and eventually I said, there is a point it has to be a leap of faith. Yeah, I have to believe. I know that God talks to me and I talk to God. I know I have a personal relationship, and I went through some other bits and bobs, but I had to say at that point, it is a leap of faith. But I couldn't say that right at the beginning. We had to go through all the different questions and answers. And if you want to think that I went, oh, that's really good, it wasn't. I just thought about how do I respond to people when they ask certain questions. And it's because when we increasingly recognise that we are children of God, we will stand in that authority. And actually the way to do that is to do this, is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind and your strength. All your soul can also be read as with all your spirit. Everything about you, start loving God and love your neighbour as yourself. And that's the most difficult, isn't it? But when we start doing all of this, when we recognise and God will impart to us how much we are his. He will constantly do it. He will want to refresh it. He keeps trying to tell us, do you know who you are in me? We tend to sort of let it bounce out. We reject it. And we can then be like this widow. I will put in my two last small coins because I know I'm a child of God. Because I know the authority I have. So if you think I'm running over time, we didn't start 5 minutes late, so we're cool. I want us to pick that up this morning. I want all of us to pick that up about who we are in God this morning. Amen?
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.